was December 1832 in Kirtland, in a conference of high priests, that the Lord commanded to establish a house of God. It would be called the Kirtland House of the Lord.
So when Joseph received the command in section 88 to build a house of God in Kirtland, he sent that revelation along with a letter to saints in Missouri and rebuked them for their slow pace and said, you'll see from this revelation, this olive leaf that the Lord has given to us, the saints in Kirtland, that he's commanded us to build a temple, and we will, the Lord being our helper, we will build it, because, Joseph said, he has promised us a visit from the heavens when we get it done. And indeed, the revelation said the saints should build a house of God and that they should have a solemn assembly in it when it was finished. They should present themselves in it sanctified. The process of building it should not just be about the outside building, but it should be about them sanctifying their lives and preparing for temple worship. And when the temple was built, they were supposed to assemble in it solemnly. And the Lord said, I will endow you with power. I'll make an appearance.
When the Kirtland Temple, even in the building of it, there are miraculous occurrences that take place. The building committee is going to receive their dimensions in a miraculous way. Frederick G. Williams will explain that they will be praying about it, and while they're praying, the temple in vision will appear to them in the distance, and that it will slowly, gradually come closer to them, that it will begin to rotate so they can see all of the details of the outside, how it's supposed to look. And then the temple will actually come over the top of them, and they find themselves inside the inner courts of the temple, jotting down, looking at the way that things are. A miraculous manifestation.
There were three floors. There was the first floor, just called the assembly court, which was divided, or could be divided by partitions, as you know. And then they had pews and benches that could be turned both ways, that could face the Aaronic priesthood one day, and this intricate system of rostrum, you know, and raised podiums. You could have it for the Aaronic priesthood, you could have it for the Melchizedek priesthood. Then on the second floor, did you know that was going to be for the school of the apostles? He's talking a lot about the school of the prophets and the school of the elders. There's going to be a school of the apostles on the second floor. And that was the floor where many of these ordinances were given. The ordinance of the endowment in its three parts, washings, anointings, washing of the feet. Well, in the fourth, the promised blessings. And on the final floor, the third floor, was the offices and administration of the church. So it was a place of dedication and inspiration and revelation in all its components. It's remarkable. It's an interesting note to note too, that on that third floor, Joseph Smith was translating the Book of Abraham. We haven't taught that very well. Joseph Smith had that Book of Abraham while still in the Kirtland Temple. And what was the origin of this endowment and the future endowments in the temple in Nauvoo is going to be coming out of Joseph Smith's translation of the Bible, Joseph Smith's translation of the Book of Abraham, and other sources. It's going to completely have an impact upon the doctrine of temple worship.
Notwithstanding the command to build the temple that came in December 1832, by June 1833, construction had not yet begun. The Lord gave a revelation chastising and rebuking the church. It is now Doctrine and Covenants 95.
All the issues of Jackson County, Missouri, and being driven and exiled from Jackson County, the resulting Camp of Israel march to Missouri, all these things intrude on his time and attention and on the building of the Kirtland Temple. And along the way, the Lord gets frustrated himself and gives a revelation in which he says to the saints, you are walking in darkness at noon because you have not considered the command I gave to you to build a temple. And there I want to endow you with power. So it was hard for the Lord and for his prophet to get the saints to appreciate what was at stake for them in the temple.
January 21st through the 22nd of 1836 was a very important date in connection with what could be considered part of the Kirtland Endowment. In the early afternoon of the 21st, Joseph Smith began to initiate some of the leading brethren in the church by performing the first washings and anointings.
So here's what Joseph Smith recorded regarding the first washings and anointings in this dispensation. January 21st, 1836. About 3 o'clock p.m., I dismissed the school and the presidency retired to the attic story of the printing office, where we attended the ordinance of washing our bodies in pure water. We also perfumed our bodies and our heads in the name of the Lord. Now he jumps and says, now we're going to talk about the anointing of oil. At early candlelight, I met with the presidency at the West schoolroom in the temple to attend the ordinance of anointing our heads with holy oil. I took the oil in my left hand, Father Smith being seated before me, and the remainder of the presidency encircled him round about. We then stretched our right hands toward heaven and blessed the oil and consecrated it in the name of Jesus Christ. We then laid our hands on our aged Father Smith and invoked the blessings of heaven. I then anointed his head with the consecrated oil and sealed many blessings upon him. The presidency then in turn laid his hands upon his head, beginning at the eldest until they had all laid their hands upon him and pronounced such blessings upon his head as the Lord put into their hearts. The presidency then took the seat in their turn according to their age, being the eldest, and received their anointing and blessing under the hand of Father Smith. And in my turn, my father anointed my head, sealed upon me the blessings of Moses to lead Israel in the latter days, even as Moses led him in the days of old. Also the blessings of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that is so powerful because we learn from section 84, verse 20 of the Doctrine and Covenants, that in the ordinances, the power of godliness is manifest. And these people felt it and were privileged to begin to receive some of these higher ordinances or ordinances unknown to the rest of the Christian world about what one must do or have to, of course, receive all of the ordinances God wants us to have in mortality.
And it included a vision of the future celestial world in which he sees his mother and father. He sees who's who of people from the scriptures. He sees God and Christ. And he sees his oldest brother, Alvin, which surprises him, since as far as Joseph knows, Alvin has gone to hell. So one of the elements of the endowment in Kirtland is the restoration of knowledge. And that knowledge is now captured for us in section 137 of the Doctrine and Covenants. And the knowledge, the precious knowledge is that nobody, not Alvin, not anybody, will be damned based on their inability to act for themselves on the restored gospel of Jesus Christ. It turns out that death is not a determinant of a person's salvation. The timing of their death has nothing to do with whether they receive all the blessings of the gospel of Jesus Christ or not. All who would have received it, the revelation says, will get that opportunity to do so, Alvin and everyone else. And that good news is so important, not just to Latter-day Saint families, but every family across the globe and throughout time will cherish that good news when it comes to their attention. So that's a major part of the Kirtland Endowment, the revelation that the celestial world is for anyone who wants it, anyone who will choose the restored gospel of Christ when it's known to them, when they have a chance to act on it for themselves. That's precious knowledge to Joseph Smith and his family and to my family and many, many others.
It was spiritually powerful, and it consisted of washings, anointings, the washing of feet, in the preparation of the gospel of peace to all the world, and perhaps most importantly, promises and covenants that were fulfilled to those who received that ordinance. Great blessings of eternal happiness. And unless the diaries are all wrong, the reverence that they spoke of this endowment that they received in the Kirtland Temple was miraculous.
Then came the day of dedication, and the powers of heaven were manifest in an extraordinary way.
They fill its pews well before the meeting is set to begin, and they've gathered there solemnly. They know by now a little bit better what's at stake. What they're anticipating is an outpouring of spiritual gifts. They expect, as William Phelps has written for the occasion, the visions and glories of God. They expect the Spirit of God like a fire to burn. They expect angels to come and visit the earth, and they're not disappointed in that.
This time surrounding the dedication of the Kirtland Temple, there's a reason why they refer to it as Pentecost. It so resembles what happens with Jesus's apostles, where the believers are gathered together and with, you know, cloven tongues of fire, right? They are these visions that they have in some of the meetings that they have. They have angels flying into the windows. Frederick G. Williams says that an angel flies through the window and sits down next to him during the prayer and then flies back out. One man's going to see an angel riding on a flaming horse surrounded by other angels with swords drawn, all to protect the saints and protect the temple. There's just so many miraculous experiences. Some will experience seeing angels in vision. Some will simply feel something powerfully and see others speaking in tongues. Others will, like Joseph, see visions of the Savior, visions of the afterlife.
They meet for half a day. They sing, they pray, they listen to extended sermons. When they come back in the afternoon, Joseph dedicates the temple in a prayer that he and his counselors and others had put together the day before. And that prayer is captured for us in section 109 of the Doctrine and Covenants. It's a temple prayer. It teaches us what temples are about, what they're for, what we can expect in temples. One of my favorite phrases in it is that Joseph asks in an inspired way, the Lord's inspired him to know what to pray for. He asks for and talks about an infinity of fullness. Think about the glorious redundancy in those words. The temple is about an infinity of fullness. It's about all of God's power and might and dominion and the what he has to share with all his children. It's not like a pizza that can only be cut up in so many pieces, and if you get some, I get less. God wants to give his children all he has, and he could give all the children who want it all they could ever want, all he has and more. This is an idea that has been articulated already a few years earlier in DNC 76, where God says and reveals to Joseph that those who inherit the fullness of his glory inherit all of his power, become like him. This is blasphemous to some people then and now. They do not like the idea that God's work is to exalt his children, to raise them to his own stature. But these are the temple doctrines. These are the ideas that are revealed and restored through Joseph Smith and that become part of the endowment of power in the Kirtland Temple.
On March 30th, 1836, the officers and elders of the church met in the House of the Lord to attend the solemn assembly, previously called for in Doctrine and Covenants, Section 88, and to receive a ritual washing of feet, an ordinance of purification. On this occasion, Joseph Smith recorded, "According to appointment, the presidency, the 12, the 70s, the high councils, the bishops and their entire quorums, the elders and all the official members in this stake of Zion, amounting to about 300, met in the temple of the Lord to attend to the ordinance of washing of feet. Tubs, water, and towels were prepared, and I called the house to order, and the presidency proceeded to wash the feet of the 12, pronouncing many prophecies and blessings upon them in the name of the Lord Jesus. The first presidency then washed the feet of the 12, and the 7 presidents of the 70. Then the 12 and the 7 presidents washed the feet of all the elders who were present. Throughout the day, the prophet gave additional instructions, and in the evening, he concluded by telling those assembled, quote, I had now completed the organization of the church, and we had passed through all the necessary ceremonies, that I had given them all the instruction they needed, and that they were now at liberty, after obtaining their licenses, to go forth and build up the kingdom of God. The next day, many of the elders left Kirtland to fulfill missions.
To me, by far the most important part, by far the most enduring part of the Kirtland Endowment is what happens on Easter Sunday in 1836, 1 week after the dedication of the temple in March. On April 3rd, Joseph Smith and Oliver Cowdery are in the temple together with other leaders of the church. They have a sacrament meeting, and then they drop the canvas curtains from the ceiling that divide the main chapel area. And near the pulpit, behind the curtains, Joseph and Oliver pray and receive an answer to their prayer, a visit from the Lord Jesus Christ. He stands on the breastwork of the pulpit, as the prophet's journal entry describes it, on a work of pure gold. And he accepts their offering in building the temple. He accepts what the saints have done in consecrating their lives to build the temple, all the money and time and effort that they've put into it. He forgives their sins, Joseph and Oliver, and he promises them some very specific things, that the good news of the gospel will go forth from this house, and that as long as they don't pollute the house, it will be a place of revelation. And then some of the greatest things that have ever happened in the history of the world follow. Moses appears and bestows upon Joseph Smith the keys of gathering Israel. And then two other angels follow in succession, one named or called Elias, and we know very little about, bestowing something called the Gospel of Abraham, or the keys for it, about which we are not sure we know everything there is to know. And then Elijah, who we know a lot more about. Elijah comes and brings what we might call the sealing keys of the holy priesthood, the keys to seal ancestors and descendants together, to bind families together across time, to destroy the devastating effects of death.
We do not know who that was. This much we do know, what Elias restores. And after this, Elias appeared and committed the dispensation of the gospel of Abraham, saying that in us and our seed, all generations after us should be blessed. It has everything to do with the future and with future families and generations, and may have included the doctrine of eternal marriage. They had the keys, the apostolic keys from Peter, James, and John. But in section 110, the Lord is beginning to reveal unto them what to do with those things, what to do with the priesthood, what to do with the keys, and to give them permission to use those keys to bless both the future and the past. One way to interpret that is that Elijah and Elias and Moses were giving them the authorization now to put those keys into full effect, to bless all these dispensations.
There are people that the Lord has assembled around Joseph to help him fulfill his mission. And his mission can be summed up in implementing the priesthood keys that were bestowed upon him on April 3rd, 1836. Once he gets those keys implemented and safely transferred to the apostles, his work is done on the earth. We know that because when he does get the keys transferred, after having endowed and sealed the apostles, or at least 9 of the 12, the same 9 who come to Utah with those keys, after he gets that work done, he feels so much different. He says, I'm light as a cork. I feel so much better. Doesn't matter what happens to me now, my work is done. And so that event of April 3rd, 1836 is unbelievably significant in the history of the world. It's not the same as the resurrection of Christ, but maybe since the resurrection of Christ, it may be the most consequential Easter we've ever had.
The blessings given in the temple fortified, energized, inspired, motivated, and lifted up the membership of the church in a way that was absolutely magnificent. To minimize that is to minimize the challenges we're going to face.
And so today when I go to the Kirtland Temple, that's what it means to me. It's a testimony of faithfulness, of the faithfulness of the Latter-day Saints to do what they'd been asked to do by the Lord, and of his faithfulness to them. He told them early in 1831, if you go to Ohio, there I will endow you with power from on high. And he told them the next year, if you build a house of God, there you will get the great and last promise, the greatest promise you will ever have. And he fulfilled those promises to them. They did what he asked them to do, and he did what he promised them he would do. And the center, the location for that is the temple in Kirtland, Ohio, which is why it's so sacred to so many of us today.